Glen Guyton is the executive director for Mennonite Church USA and has more than a quarter century of experience serving in the denomination at various levels. Often recognized for his quick-witted humor and relatability, Glen has enjoyed speaking on complex issues with many diverse groups. He has authored two books, and he holds a Bachelor of Science in Management from the United States Air Force Academy and a Master of Education from Regent University. He currently resides in San Antonio, Texas, with his wife and two adult children. Please join us in welcoming Glen Guyton.
I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings, no. Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you. I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I've sang another song. Take me back to where we start. I open up my heart to you. I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything. And more than anything that you can do, I just want you. Come on, you can sing it with us. I just want you. Nothing else. Nothing else. Nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else, nothing else, Jesus, nothing else will do. Oh, I just want you. Nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else, nothing else. Nothing else to do. Come on. I just want you. I just want you. I just want you. Nothing else will do. Oh, I just want you. Nothing else. Nothing else. Nothing else. I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything. And more than anything that you can do, I just want you. You know, this could really be a short message if we could all agree that Jesus is enough, that God is in control, and that if we focused on the gospel, the good news, that our world would be a much better place. But if we could do that, people, if we could just enjoy the simple, we wouldn't need all of these church gurus, we wouldn't need all of these denominations, we wouldn't need all of these institutions. So I want to make sure that you get your money's worth today, that I earn my massive executive director salary. Just kidding about that. But I'm going to spend about a half hour up here on stage. Don't get nervous, anyone. We're going to spend some time up here. But the real message is that Jesus is enough. That if we just did what Jesus did, if we followed the example of Christ, we would be able to fulfill that message of bringing the peace. And so, as we start today, and John Carlson touched on this, love is the starting point of our journey. We must be obedient to the very important commandment and call that is prominent in God's direction to Moses and Christ's command to his disciple. We have to love one another. That's our starting point. Loving one another. That's how we begin to bring the peace. And so I want us to read a scripture together. I'm going to read the regular type, but I want you to read the highlighted portion of this. So we're going to ask them to bring the scripture up on the screen. This is my commandment. As I have loved you, greater love has no one than this. You are my friends if you do whatever I command. No longer do I call you servants, for a servant does not know what his master is doing. For all things that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. But I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give you. John chapter 15. So love is both a commitment and a sacrifice. Love can be a struggle, but love is a bond that is not easily broken. Love is mutual. Love is gracious. Love is our spiritual trump card. In order to bring the peace, we also have to understand that we are connected, and Pastor Megan did a good job of talking about being attracted to Christ. But we have to understand that we are connected. We are called to be connected in ways that the world cannot understand. And we have to understand that God is our source. As the people of God, we have to be mindful that God is the source of our strength. Now look, I know we've had some struggles since we've come together as a denomination in 2001. We have numerous polarizations, and many of the speakers here on stage have alluded to those polarizations. We have various traditions, GCs, the MCs, and the all about the MEs, or the Mees, that's what I call them, the Mees. And not to mention all of the geographic and racial diversity that we have in our congregations. Dealing with people can be messy. But the early Mennonites were so passionate and so devoted to their faith that they messed up. And they shared this great Anabaptist theology with us BIPOC folks and many others. Who would have thought that if you took this message that we had, this rich Anabaptist tradition from the rural parts of our country to the urban centers, to the barrios, that it wouldn't begin to change, that it wouldn't begin to transform in ways that imitated the gifts and the needs of the communities that adopted this new message, this Anabaptist message. To bring the peace, we have to understand the power that we have as a church. In order to effectively bring the peace, we must remember the true power of the church. So what is that power? Here's an excerpt from my most recent book, available on Amazon and Harold Press. What is the power of the church? If you can bring that slide up. What is the power of the church? The power of the church is not found in its icons or its hierarchy or its bureaucracy. The real power of the church lies in its ability to transfer the hopes and dreams of its lowest members into action. Simply put, the power of the church lies in transformation. While transformation will look different in different communities and with different people the church serves, the mission of the church is always to prepare people for transformation to happen. And this power is illustrated in the books of Ezra and Nehemiah. Professor Andrew Hill states, the labors of Ezra and Nehemiah to rebuild and reform post-exilic Jerusalem was largely inspired by the theological truth of Yahweh as covenant keeper. And I think we've heard some of that this week. Ezra and Nehemiah illustrated unwavering hope and certainty through which a marginalized community was able to center itself and rebuild. While individuals had specific roles and duties in the process, the institution of religion helped to lay the foundation for the restoration and rebuilding of the community. Our power is to be that symbol of hope, restoration, and renewal in the community. If we can acknowledge the power that we have as a church, not only will we survive, but we will thrive. We spend way too much time worrying about what we are losing rather than focusing on where we can grow and what we have to offer as the body of Christ. Now, I believe that our denomination is contracting for two reasons, so bear with me on this. First of all, it's poor leadership. Now, I don't want to spend too much time on this. We don't have enough time to cover that. But we have designed leadership systems that don't fit who we are theologically. Bureaucracy is a deadly thing. Believe me, I deal with it all the time. We have way too many managers and seat fillers where we need more leaders with vision, compassion, and roof-ripping faith. Now, if you want to know, understand what roof-ripping faith is, go to the Gospel of Mark, chapter 2. But I want you to know this. We all need friends who are willing to tear some stuff up in order to get closer to God. We need to have that in our church. We need to have that roof-ripping faith. The other problem is thinking that we control transformation, that we are in control. But God is in control. God repeatedly tells us in Scripture not to worry. God's word is full of promises. Those promises are written throughout Scripture and symbolically illustrated in creation. In Psalm 125, verse 2, it says, as the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people both now and forevermore. Jerusalem is surrounded by natural protection, natural fortification. You have Mount Zion on one side, the Mount of Olives, I believe, to the east, and then you have other mountains surrounding it. And so as we think about that, just as Jerusalem is fortified with those natural fortifications, God surrounds us and protects us with his favor and loving kindness. He is our shield and guards us with his providential hand. God does not leave us or forsake us, but guides us even unto death. When you are worried, church, when you are afraid, just remember that God is in control and that God's love surrounds us on all sides. Point number four, stay connected to the vine. If we stay anchored in Christ, we will not only survive again, but we will thrive as a church. And the vine is strong enough to change the characteristics of anything that it comes in contact with. I want to give you a little analogy. If you are from the South, anybody here from the South? Any Southern people? Clap your hands. If you know Southern, I have some Texas people here. Come on, that's kind of the South. All right. You might be familiar, if you're from the South, with a vine called kudzu. Let me show you what kudzu. All right. So kudzu is a perennial invasive vine native to China, Japan, and the Indian subcontinent. Kudzu is also known as the foot at night vine because that's how fast it grows, right? And the vine that ate the South. Kudzu is unstoppable, like the gospel. You have heard me say over and over again, some of you that have been here for a while, that our documents will not save us. Because they won't. What will save us is a renewed focus on the Lordship of Jesus Christ and the ability to model the love, unity, and sacrificial love demonstrated in Scripture. You know, we just have so many different parts of our church, and so many people that are lamenting, you know, that the church has changed. One of the things I like to say is that, you know, that the original, you know, the OG Mennonites, the original Mennonites, y'all look up OG on Urban Dictionary when y'all get home. The OG Mennonites, you know, they messed up. They shared this rich gospel message, and it began to change. And so I want to tell people, don't be mad. Don't be upset that the church has changed. Be happy that our church has endured. That our church continues. That even though it may look different, it endures. Because we are connected to the source. One part of the church is crying, saying, we want and need affirmation from you. Acknowledge us. You know, we're here. Why don't you see us? And they all call me. Another part of the church is crying, hey, things are changing. We like the good old days. You know, do our voices matter anymore? Our forefathers built this church. Another part of the church is crying, well, I guess I have to be white and Swiss German in order to matter. Why did you invite us here if you didn't really want us here? Another part of the church is saying, why can't we all get along? Hush, hush, keep it down now. Voices carry. That's what they're saying. We don't want to cause any trouble. We just want to be together in a slow death that's better than ruffling feathers. And then another part of the church is like saying, hey, you Mennonites are great. How can we join you? You all got it all together. You all are so peaceful. And you know what I want to say to those people? All those different groups that call me and email me. I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I've sang another song. That's what I want to say, that Jesus is enough. And so as we think about bringing peace, my fifth and final point is we need to be transformed. We need to be transformed. To bring the peace, to survive, to answer the call of God, we have to change. Church, we have to change. We must reject our fear. We must reject our sinful nature. We must reject worldly disputes. We must reject false purity. We must give control to God. We must believe that God is, and that God is a rewarder of those that seek him with diligence. We must have faith that God is big enough. We must be transformed, church. During this next biennium, we will focus on transformation. Now, some of you are going to leave here bogged down by the weight of the past. Some of you will leave here just as hopeless as you were yesterday. And I'm sorry for that. I'm sorry for the pain that you really feel, that you genuinely feel. I'm sorry for the people and the institutions that have done real harm to you. And I'm sorry that you have to carry that weight when you leave this place. But I urge you not to let them continue, whoever them are, they. Don't let them have power over you. The peace of Christ is available to you as well. And so I leave you with this. For the rest of my vine-connected leaders who are connected, I want you to think about this scripture. And not only that, but we also glory in our tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, perseverance, character, and character hope. Now, hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. We have that hope. So for the rest of my leaders, my vine connected, Anabaptists filled with the Holy Spirit, for those who love this church, those of you who are filled with hope, I ask that you be gracious and kind to those who are still on their journey, those that have been traumatized and those that are seeking restoration. Let us set the example. Let us be advocates and allies for the marginalized. Let us demonstrate the love of Christ in word and deed to those that don't feel like this church is their home. However they identify themselves, let us call them to the foot of the cross, because God is enough and nothing else will do. It's time for Mennonite Church USA to be transformed. When we leave here today, church, will you still remember me? For we must be traveling on now, 'cause there's too many places we've got to see. But if I stay here with you, church, because I'm as free as a dove now, but this dove, it must change. Whoa. And this dove, it can change. Yes, this dove, it has changed. Bye bye, church, it's been sweet love. Though this message I can't change, please don't take it so badly. knows we've got to change. If I stay here with you, church, things just couldn't be the same. 'Cause I'm as free as a dove now, but this dove, it must change. You know this dove, it has to change. Lord knows we can change. Lord help us, we can change. Thank you.